Welcome to Presidential Libraries, Museums, and More, taking you on an exciting journey through our presidential history. I'm your host, Patrick Clark. We begin today by honoring the life of our 41st president, the late George Herbert Walker Bush, who was laid to rest recently in Texas. That's where the nation came to pay their final respects. Let's head to College Station, to the George H.W. Bush Presidential Library and Museum.
There were planes, trains, and automobiles transporting former presidents and world leaders.
Well-loved here in this community, but well-loved in Texas, and I think well-loved. They were both well-loved everywhere.
He was always, you know, accessible, and he, you know, you could walk up to him and say hello.
The state funeral of George Herbert Walker Bush began in Houston, Texas, continued to Washington, D.C., and ended at his library and museum in College Station.
He valued character over pedigree, and he was no cynic. He looked for the good in each person, and he usually found it.
Along the way, members of all five branches of the armed services took part. From a 21-jet salute to the 4141 Union Pacific train carrying the president from Houston, Texas to College Station.
I think he was a great president. Great character, and I think that will be remembered years down the line.
8 months earlier, in April 2018, just a day after former First Lady Barbara Bush was laid to rest, the George Bush Presidential Library and Museum was open to the public as many came to pay their last respects. And the same held true after the 41st president was buried at his library, next to his wife Barbara and daughter Robin.
We'd see him on campus and the students loved him, and he was at football games and baseball games, basketball games. He was just a man's man. He did everything. I don't think I've ever heard a negative comment about him in my whole life, and I'm proud of that.
So things will change. It'll be different. They've been a fixture here, you know, at the library, you know, between October and when they went to Maine in April or May. For so many years that, you'd see the dogs and then you knew they were here.
Now people are going to be visiting him a different way. They're going to be paying their respects to him as he lies in peace in the family grave sites.
And so the Presidential Library and Museum that tells the story of George Herbert Walker Bush and his wife Barbara and our nation now becomes a forever home for number 41. Taking an intimate stroll inside his library, you'll find many unique items on display that give you a personal feel for who President George Herbert Walker Bush was and what he stood for.
We were dedicated in November of 1997. It's approximately 69,000 square feet, housing over 100,000 artifacts, 2 million photographs, hundreds of hours of video.
George Herbert Walker Bush was President of the United States from January 20th, 1989 until January 20th, 1993. There's plenty of ground to cover at his museum, and what better way to do so than with a presidential limousine?
This is no ordinary car.
No, this is a Lincoln Presidential Edition, actually. It was used in his inaugural parade.
Do yourself a favor and look up, and you'll find a fighter plane from the Second World War. It's the kind that a teenage George H.W. Bush flew as the youngest Navy pilot at the time.
It's called the Avenger Torpedo Bomber, and it's an actual plane. It's not the same one he flew, but this is the same type of plane he flew. He was one of the youngest naval pilots. He joined right at 18, after seeing Pearl Harbor. That really inspired him to join and to serve, and that's when really his public service began.
After the war, Bush would attend Yale University, playing first base for the Bulldogs.
He was the captain of the Yale baseball team, and one of the things that he always did was have a glove with him. So in each position, every, public, whatever he was serving, whether it was congressman, director of the CIA, or wherever he served, he always had this baseball mitt somewhere, whether it was in the drawer or whatnot, because he just loved the game.
His love of public service led him to become a congressman, an ambassador to the United Nations, envoy to China, and director of the CIA. After serving as Ronald Reagan's vice president for 8 years, Bush made a run for president and won.
So here we are in the Oval Office, here we are at the desk, and once again, going through the drawers, and what do you find? There's the glove.
Put yourself in his shoes, or at least his seat in this Oval Office, or make your way past his Camp David office, Run by the National Archives and Records Administration, the George Bush Library is home to quite a collection of cars, boats, planes, and more. Outside, walking the grounds, you'll find a lake, some nice spring flowers, and the burial site for the first man and first lady. As you make your way through the museum, you can head back to the early 1990s and the Persian Gulf War.
This exhibit here shows that from beginning to end, and how he dealt with it, how he reacted, and how he showed true leadership during that time.
Inside, you'll find a safe landing and the parachute used by the adventurous former president, right next to the colorful socks worn with his friend, former President Bill Clinton, on a fundraising mission.
There's not too many people who have done that. No, not too many people who have been in that, you know, the leader of the free world position. There's only been a few, and there's a good reason for that, because the country, you know, tries to get the best we can in that position.
George Herbert Walker Bush, our nation's 41st president. Ahead on Presidential Libraries, Museums, and More, our journey takes us to Virginia, where we check out Woodrow Wilson's Presidential Library. We take a peek inside this very impressive pre-Civil War home.
He was wildly popular during his tenure in office, but some digging in the dirt has uncovered some new insight into this place he called home. We'll take you into James Monroe's Highland.
Presidential Libraries, Museums, and More continues, this time in Virginia, with a man who is both friends and neighbors to Thomas Jefferson. This is James Monroe's Highland.
Digging into the history of America might lead you to Virginia, where they're digging up some new details about our fifth U.S. president.
Here we are at James Monroe's Highland, which is a small historic site outside of Charlottesville, Virginia.
James Monroe, the fifth United States president, was good friends with number three, Thomas Jefferson.
Jefferson worked hard to create what he called a society to our taste and lobbied hard to have his friends and associates move to him in Albemarle County.
Monroe bought this property next to Jefferson's Mountain and moved here in 1799.
Yeah, this was his main home, as well as a productive plantation. For a long time, it was thought to be the remnant wing of a larger house, of which the larger portion was destroyed by fire. We made a research announcement that re-identified this little house not as a wing of anything, but as its own thing, Monroe's guest house, a cottage he built during his presidency in 1818.
During an archaeological dig, they discovered the remains of the main house from 1799.
And so he had these men build the house, I think because the demands of the presidency required that every time he came here, he had visitors as well as people coming with him.
The presidential guest house in Charlottesville allowed visitors their own quarters, and Monroe could keep working on leading the nation. James Monroe, one of the last founding fathers, served as president from March 4, 1817 until March 4, 1825. Misidentified for centuries, it was dendrochronology, or tree ring dating, that helped determine another house had once stood here.
Tree ring dating gave us a very firm date on the wood that was used to build the presidential guest house.
There are two Monroe trees still standing on the property from his time on Earth.
The most notable one is the grand white oak behind me here. And we think that was, in fact, standing behind the president's house while he lived here. But we lay these flagstones down in order to help people understand exactly where the house was and, in fact, to see its extent.
Officials at Monroe's Highland are looking into the enslaved men and women who worked at the site and reaching out to their descendants.
People visiting Highland will hear an evolving story about James Monroe with new research all the time. So it's a real privilege and opportunity to be doing this work now.
Inside the house, you'll find a sampler stitched by 11-year-old Maria Monroe, the president's daughter.
And so this bed is the Monroe's bed that they owned and presumably slept in. Monroe was a multi-term governor of Virginia when that was legal, for Madison, Secretary of State, and then briefly and simultaneously Secretary of War during the War of 1812. Several other offices, all before he was a two-term and very popular U.S. president.
Visitors to the president's house would have eaten off these porcelain plates featuring an American eagle with 20 stars, representing the 20 states in the Union at the time of Monroe's tenure.
Apparently these were both used in the White House, and they're both French. The Monroes, of course, were widely traveled and were known as bringing French taste to the White House.
That's the William King chair in the middle, an armchair from the White House, and this Russian chair in the collection when the Russian ambassador left the U.S. and Monroe picked up the chair and others like it in a moving sale. You can get lost and found on the grounds of Monroe's Highland Estate.
Monroe was a tall, athletic, military man. He was vibrant and apparently, a quote from a contemporary was said to have put women and men at ease in social situations. Gentleman's gentleman, you know, well-mannered and pleasant and as well as sort of physically imposing.
And you can walk in his shoes in Charlottesville, Virginia, where they'll keep digging up new information on our fifth U.S. president. We're on the road again. The next stop on our presidential library and museum tour takes us just 43 miles west to Woodrow Wilson's presidential library and museum. It's not uncommon to head to the Commonwealth of Virginia and find yourself at a presidential location or two.
The Woodrow Wilson Presidential Library and Museum. We are in Stanton, Virginia, which is in the heart of the Shenandoah Valley. We have about 25,000 people, and we're about 45 minutes to the west of Charlottesville. We have seven buildings, believe it or not, and we all started with the place where Woodrow Wilson was born, the birthplace manse.
The Presidential Library and Museum encompasses Wilson's life and times, and the complex, an entire city block.
And it starts from the year he was born, 1856, until 1924 when he passed away. And if you can imagine all of the things that happened during his lifetime, that was pre-Civil War through the end of World War I.
Inside this pre-Civil War home, now considered a National Historic Landmark, you can find everything from presidential china to one of the first White House phones used by the 28th president.
He actually is the only president that we had that actually earned a PhD, and he earned that in political science. And he's also known now as kind of the father of public administration in the United States. And it was very interesting. He did not learn to read until he was older than 10 years old. He had what we think today was probably dyslexia.
His father was a Presbyterian minister, and the manse provided by the church to the family. Wilson was born in this house in 1856.
Come on in. We'll show you some things here in the collection. The first item that I want to show you, this is Wilson's top hat. This is the hat that he wore when he went to Europe at the end of war, to Versailles to negotiate the peace at the Paris Peace Conference.
This cane, given to Wilson by soldiers who worked on this while in the trenches during World War I. Look for the bullets in the handle of the cane. While he was not a great golfer, he loved the game using this wooden driver. This was his golf bag, but it was not a golf cart that Wilson enjoyed the most. It was this mode of transportation, the chariot of the president, the Pierce Arrow.
When he came back from Paris and negotiating the Paris Peace Conference, that was the car that was waiting on him. He fell absolutely in love with that car. And actually when his term ended, his friends from Princeton purchased the car. And if you notice on the side, you'll see a thin orange stripe, and that's the orange from Princeton that is on there. And he kept that was his favorite car.
Woodrow Wilson was the first president to be a member of the American Automobile Association, now known as AAA.
We know the car in that time period would have gone about 60 miles per hour. That would have been as fast, but he believed in going about 25 or 30. He was not a speedster.
At the Presidential Center, you'll find a trench warfare simulation and the brutal effects of the Great War. Wilson guided the United States through World War I with his PhD in political science.
We're in the ending the 100th anniversary of the First World War and the commemorations that will be going on with that. So there's so much to learn in that time period. Everything from the women's suffrage movement to domestic reform, 8-hour workday. Who would have thought something like that would have been so important? But that came through Woodrow Wilson.
His administration set things in place that are still with us today.
Everything from the Federal Reserve System to the income tax and how that whole system is whether we like it or not, it all goes back. No one's found anything better. And so Wilson can take a lot of credit for that. A lot of other wonderful programs, something as simple as Mother's Day. He was the one that made that a holiday.
He would stop through Stanton from time to time and refer to it as his hometown.
He actually came back to Stanton after he had been elected, but before he was inaugurated in 1912 for his birthday. He spent two nights in the house where he was born.
Visitors to this Stanton, Virginia site might notice it's somewhat easy to view Wilson through today's lens.
I think that's the real important piece of why all of us exist as presidential libraries and presidential sites, is because we have so much to share with the public so that we can learn from that and become more enlightened citizens.
As Wilson himself said, I not only use all the brains that I have, but all that I can borrow. Here are a few fun facts about our nation's 28th president. Woodrow Wilson's first name was actually Thomas. He went by the name Thomas until about 18 years of age. He put the first Jewish justice on the Supreme Court. In 1916, President Wilson pushed for Louis Brandeis to be named to the High Court against fierce opposition. In the end, he prevailed. And Woodrow Wilson is the only president buried in Washington, D.C. in the National Cathedral, taking on the task of painting a president. We speak with the man behind the brush, artist Kehinde Wiley, the creator of the official portrait of President Barack Obama. He's the man behind the official presidential portrait of Barack Obama. Now Kehinde Wiley has come to town to put the faces of St. Louis and Ferguson on the walls of the St. Louis Art Museum. We'll take you inside. Kehinde Wiley has spent the last 3 years working on capturing the essence of St. Louis in Ferguson, Missouri.
The name of the exhibition itself is St. Louis. People, all of my subjects, were minding their own business, trying to get to work. I basically tried to convince them that I was legitimate and that they should become subjects in my work.
And when I pulled up, there was just a whole bunch of cameras, and I was fussing at her about coming on, and Mr. Kehinde was there, and he invited us, and here we are. And I must say, his work is amazing.
When former President Barack Obama was looking for someone to paint his official portrait for the National Gallery in Washington, D.C., he wound up choosing Wiley.
I tried to negotiate smaller ears.
For the presidential portrait, for the portrait of Barack Obama, you don't just get the job. So there were a number of artists who were invited to the Oval Office back in 2016.
I tried to negotiate less gray hair. And Kehinde's artistic integrity would not allow him to do what I asked.
I was incredibly nervous, and essentially it was the most high-pressure job interview you can imagine for an artist.
Nobody in my family tree, as far as I can tell, had a portrait done. I do have my high school yearbook picture.
Well, the portrait has a lot of allegorical meaning. Each of the flowers represents a different period in his life. There's a flower from Indonesia, there's a flower from Hawaii, one from Chicago. What I'm trying to do there is to draw a type of narrative line in that painting. Why is he not wearing a tie? Why is he leaning forward towards the viewer rather than sitting apart? All those slight moments in a painting can really give a sense of someone's character or someone's intent or a set of ideals.
He's come to town to put St. Louis on his canvas.
I created a photo shoot using poses that come from great masterworks in the museum's permanent collection.
And using those as a basis for the paintings that you see here. So every subject that you see in these works is based on a painting, or, and in one case, a sculpture in our collection.
And that's one of the things that's so interesting about this painting, which is based on a 1920 German expressionist painting by the painter Otto Muller.
I think it's important that museums reflect the times and reflect the societies.
I mean, even the muscles in my arms, I'm just looking at his artwork and it's just amazing.
When I went to the Smithsonian and saw the National Portrait Gallery's collection of presidential portraits, And to see mine next to all of these moments in history was just so awe-inspiring. The sense in which painting can have a social presence, something as simple as taking colored paste and a hairy stick and moving things around, can revolutionize the way that young people start thinking about themselves and thinking about the presence of black bodies on big white walls.
Wiley's paintings have been featured in museums across America, around the world, and now at the Smithsonian.
They're the political paintings that are the talk of the nation. We'll take you inside this Missouri Painter studio and show you the originals. Since the very first man, George Washington, it's been tradition for presidents to have an oil painting or portrait made for the National Gallery. We recently met a man who's been making paintings, collecting presidents, and caught the attention of number 45. Let's head to the Show Me State to meet Andy Thomas.
In southwest Missouri is where paint and pop culture meet in the little town of Carthage. Artist Andy Thomas has been painting his whole life, but it's his recent political portraits that have been the talk of the nation.
When I did the paintings, I thought, oh, this would be nice. People, you know, these are all our presidents, you know, they'll put both up. And, you know, it'd be in like a den or something like that. No, that's not the case at all. You know, they either buy Republican or they buy Democrat. And if they buy both of them, it's to throw darts at the other one. So.
It was California Republican Representative Daryl Issa who gave a copy of Thomas's The Republican Club painting to number 45.
Had a really nice conversation with him. He personally has a very friendly voice, very engaging voice, and very complimentary. He's told me he was in the Oval Office with Daryl Issa and Vice President Pence, and they're looking at the painting.
Thomas's presidential paintings feature a who's who list of storied leaders. After a picture surfaced of his print hanging in the White House, his phone started ringing with calls from around the world. And then he got a call from the president.
He did say, I don't usually like portraits of myself painted, but I really like what you've done here. And I can tell you why, because he's very difficult to paint. You know, he's... you know, the shadows, nothing about him makes it easy to do a good portrait. And the hair is, of course, very difficult. You know, you can't even really find the edge.
Thomas has an equally popular painting entitled The Democratic Club, featuring JFK, Bill Clinton, and Barack Obama, among others. He spends months researching his subjects and finding their best sides.
Well, Trump was tough because this is the second version of him I painted. In the first one, I had a really sweet smile. This is, of course, Abraham Lincoln. And I would think that given his great sense of humor and his prestige, that he would pretty much dominate. The people would be deferential to Abraham Lincoln, you know. But Lincoln would still be telling jokes, and he was Mark Twain caliber wit, you know. So I'm imagining that Lincoln has just said something, you know, precise and witty, and everybody's reacting to it. If I'm not happy with a face, I'm just crushed, and I try to, you know, I'll go back and try correcting it many times or wiping it off and trying to get a better face. Sometimes I just can't get there, and I finally have to say I guess that's as good as I can do.
This artist who made his name making paintings of the West has set up his bipartisan portraits of presidents, enjoying each other's conversations and company.
So I try to make everybody good looking if I can, and happy. They're really feel-good paintings, so, you know, it's supposed to be like, you'd want to be there listening to them talk.
Well, that's all the time we have for right now, but make sure to join us again. I'm Patrick Clark. We'll see you next time on Presidential Libraries, Museums, and More.